Good morning. Thank you for having me here. Very much I appreciate it. I'm Seth Myers from the Economic Development Corporation. It's our vision to make New York City the global model for inclusive innovation and economic growth. EDC manages a number of waterfront assets on the city's behalf, and the city's economic development strategy aims to leverage these assets for inclusive, resilient, and sustainable economic growth throughout the city. The city's 520 miles of waterfront have been a central part of our city's past and present a key to our future. They are in the midst of an enormous transformation. Over the last two decades, nearly 3,000 acres of waterfront land have been rezoned for residential and commercial uses. New Yorkers now have access to 220 miles of publicly accessible areas on the waterfront and destination waterfront parks. We're continuing that effort to unlock the full development potential of our waterfront. A few examples: in Hunters Point South in Queens, and at the former Homeport Naval Base in Stapleton, Staten Island, EDC and the city are essentially creating resilient and affordable new neighborhoods. At the Brooklyn Army Terminal in Sunset Park, city investments will continue growth and result in a manufacturing hub that will have hundreds of companies and employ nearly 6,000 people in innovative, light manufacturing jobs. We're also leveraging our waterfront assets to increase public access and recreational space, from the development of Hunters Point South Park with the Parks Department to the transformation of an abandoned industrial waterfront into Bush Terminal Piers Park in South Brooklyn. We're committed to reconnecting the city to some of its most useful and beautiful assets: green space and a vibrant waterfront. As you know, 2 weeks ago, Mayor de Blasio released One NYC, the city's strategic plan for strengthening equity and resiliency. And the waterfront plays a central role in that plan. From the Rockaways, where we're building a new boardwalk that doubles as an effective levee, to resiliency upgrades at Hunts Point, we're partnering with the Office of Resiliency and Recovery to strengthen the environmental protections along the waterfront throughout the five boroughs. And we're working on enhancing the city's logistics and freight capacity, enhancing multimodal alternatives to highways with a central role for the city and region's waterfront. The Anchorage Channel between Brooklyn and Staten Island is an integral part of the shipping trade in New York Harbor. In order to accommodate the larger new Panamax cargo ships, that channel has to be deepened. With the Department of Environmental Protection and the Port Authority, EDC is completing a massive tunneling and piping project that will allow the dredging needed to deepen the channel to happen. The increased maritime freight capacity that this unlocks will be facilitated by two other investments: Staten Island's Global Container Terminal, where we've spent up to over $80 million to expand the berth lengths, and the Arthur Killift, Bayonne, and Goethals bridges, all of which will allow more shipping capacity. And secondly, at the South Brooklyn Marine Terminal in Sunset Park, where we recently concluded a deal with the city council to bring the terminal back online. SBMT is the only maritime industrial site with direct rail access to Queens, Brooklyn, and Long Island, opening up an entirely new ship-to-rail-based logistics network through that entire market. Linking those facilities, a rail car float operated by the New York, New Jersey Rail, a clear example of how marine connections have remained and will continue to be critical to transportation and connectivity. And the question of the day: how do we strengthen New Yorkers' connection to the waterfront and enhance equity through multimodal transport? We have the best municipal transit system in the country here, but that system is running up against its limits. And we can see that increasing it is increasingly challenging and expensive. So as Mayor de Blasio announced a few months ago, the city of New York is overseeing the greatest expansion in ferry service seen in New York Harbor in decades. The new citywide ferry service will build off of the successes of the existing East River ferry service. It will increase connections to over 20 landings around the city, starting with three new routes in 2017. And by 2018, we will have two additional routes serving 12 more waterfront communities. The citywide ferry service will provide transit connections to waterfront communities around the city that are currently underserved by transit and unlock development in transit-challenged areas, increasing equity, resiliency, and economic benefits. Today, job growth is continuing to occur in new places outside of Manhattan's traditional central business district, places like Astoria, Long Island City, Red Hook, Sunset Park. The citywide ferry service will support this growth and connect people and businesses across the city for just the cost of a subway ride. But let's be clear, the citywide ferry service is not, and doesn't seek to be, a substitute to subways or buses. The mayor has committed to expanding 13 new select bus service lines throughout the city, and his budget funds that bus expansion through a $295 million allocation. What the citywide ferry service does do is add a vital and complementary addition to our existing transportation system. Think of the waterfront communities where someone in the Rockaways or Soundview needs to get to Midtown Manhattan, or from the Astoria houses to work in South Brooklyn. This service means they would no longer have to walk as much as 30 minutes to the closest subway stop before spending another hour on the train. Ferries can make these interborough trips more directly. Already, there are more than 500,000 residents and almost 17,000 NYCHA units that are within half a mile of a ferry landing that will be directly served by the new system. But this system will also not just enhance cross-borough access, but facilitate the development of these new areas. The waterfront neighborhoods will also be home to thousands of new affordable housing units and development added over the next decade, supported by these ferry systems. The service also adds redundancy to our transportation network, extremely important as we saw following Sandy. When the L train was out of service, some 7,400 commuters took the East River Ferry on a single day in early November. And ferries were also able to reconnect communities in Red Hook, the Rockaways, and Staten Island quickly after the storm. All of this value, access, resiliency, and development, come at a relatively low upfront capital cost, just $55 million for service throughout the city. Compare that with the amount of time and billions of dollars for any expanded or new subway line. And for those who are concerned about the subsidies involved in operation of ferries, we believe that we can set up this expanded service in a way that is both affordable and fiscally responsible. Some have confused the subsidy numbers associated with the previous Rockaway Ferry service with this new effort. The Rockaway Ferry was brought online in the wake of Hurricane Sandy under emergency conditions, resulting in a subsidy of $33 per rider. That high price is precisely why we had to end the service last fall. But, and this is important, when the entire citywide system comes online, the combination of multiple routes and the right operating conditions will place the entire system on a better financial footing. For the overall system, we are projecting our fare box recovery rate will be almost 45%, a subsidy of less than $5 per ride. We'll be working with the MTA and city DOT to coordinate ferry service with the rest of the transit system. And we're currently going through an RFP process or selection process for the system operator and plan to start discussions with respondents in June. So let me conclude by saying that New York City has a harbor and a system of waterways that can support a robust logistics network as well as recreational access. And I'm excited to say that soon we'll also have an expanded ferry network which improves access, equity, and resiliency and connects New Yorkers from one end of the city to the other. Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask Douglas Adams, who's the Chief Operating Officer for the Waterfront Alliance, as it's now called, to give us, fill in some of the outline that Seth just sketched out for us. Where are these routes going to be? Who are they going to serve? What are some of the juicy details and logistics that folks on this deck are going to appreciate probably more than anybody? Take it away.
Thanks so much. Thank you. And thank you, Joan, and thank you, Seth. In addition to being Chief Operating Officer at the Waterfront Alliance, I have over 10 years of transportation planning experience, including previously with Sam Schwartz. You noticed we just switched the slide. You can see the planned citywide ferry service network. A little bit of background on the Waterfront Alliance's work in this area, and then I'll fill in some of those details that Joan asked for. Since our creation in 2007, the Waterfront Alliance has been the city's primary voice advocating for expanded ferry service. In addition to advancing ferry policy, we work closely with ferry activists in underserved communities. For instance, we gathered over 1,000 signatures almost overnight in Soundview in the Bronx in support of ferry service there. And we'll be honoring the amazing work of many of those neighborhood ferry activists later today at our Heroes of the Harbor Awards ceremony with you. Ferries are not a silver bullet, and no single transportation mode is, but they are an important piece of a robust public transportation network. And there's no other means of quickly and efficiently linking transit-poor waterfront neighborhoods to jobs, which is so important to Mayor de Blasio. Implementation is relatively cheap, requiring little infrastructure beyond the landings and vessels. They're also resilient, adding system redundancy and critical service when emergencies knock down other forms of transit. And a ferry network is flexible. If it doesn't work, you haven't invested a lot, and worst case, you have infrastructure in place when needed in emergencies. Oh, and they're fun and relaxing to ride. As referenced by Seth, it's no accident that they're included in the de Blasio administration's recently released One NYC plan for a strong and just city. They offer transit equity for disconnected waterfront neighborhoods and add options to our transportation network, making it stronger. And the East River Ferry Service is a great example of their potential, with an affordable fare and generally frequent service, resulting in twice as many passengers as were predicted. Following Mayor de Blasio's announcement in February, New York City Economic Development Corporation issued an RFP for citywide ferry service. Responses to that RFP are due next month. Echoing Seth's remarks, and as described in the RFP, highlights of the service include five new routes serving 13 new locations in all five boroughs, with over 4.5 million passengers predicted in 2018. The Astoria, Rockaway, and South Brooklyn routes are scheduled to start in 2017, followed by the Lower East Side and Soundview routes in 2018. The $55 million in capital that Seth referenced to construct ferry landings, it's a New York bargain. It's a rounding error in typical transit infrastructure dollars. And the fare will be affordable, same as the subway, with free transfers between routes. And we've learned from the East River Ferry that ferry subsidies are competitive, with a $2.20 per passenger subsidy on the East River Ferry versus a $15 per passenger subsidy for express bus service. That ferry service subsidy is also less than the subsidy per passenger for the Staten Island Ferry and the Long Island Railroad and is comparable to the local bus subsidy. Again, ferries are not a silver bullet, but for a growing city, particularly one growing on the waterfront, they're an affordable, resilient, and flexible complement to the overall transportation network and necessary to fulfill the mayor's vision of a stronger and more just city. And we're excited to work with the city and the mayor to make citywide ferry service successful.
Thank you very much. We're very excited to have Councilmember Yudanis Rodriguez here. As you probably know, he is chair of the City Council Transportation Committee, and in that role has been a strong ally to a lot of the grassroots organizations and New York City residents all over on issues from pedestrian and bike safety, improving our pedestrian bicycle infrastructure, and dear to my heart, expanding select bus service. The area that you represent, council member, I'm trying to find it on this map of the ferry proposal, and I'm not seeing it. So I hope that you'll talk to us both about the potential you see in the mayor's proposal and some of the other gaps that need to be filled and your own vision on that.
Great. First of all, I would like to thank everyone, especially the other members of the panels, and also one of the person, Roland Lewis, who also is a great leader, a visionary, and the Metropolitan Water Alliance. You know, you are the pioneer. And this is something that I admire. And one of the things that I always say that we, this generation, has to learn from the previous generation is that these cities always have men and women with vision for the future. And sometimes what we propose is not popular. However, when we know that something is need and that something is critical for taking our city where we should be in the future, no doubt that there has to be a chapter for the Metropolitan Water Alliance, because you have made a case of how important is water transportation. See, the water transportation is not something that is a luxury. It's something that is needed. It's critical. And we saw on the Sandy, and we have seen when the city or any other city in the nation has been hit by a natural disaster, water transportation is key to bring that services back to those who need it the most. So when I look on how important it is to establish a West Side ferry line, I see also in the same direction of where our city is going to be by 2030, when we know that we will be adding an additional 1 million New Yorkers in our city who will need transportation. And the city also has been growing with the number of tourists. Yes, last year we got 57 million tourists that came to our city. So when we plan our transportation, we cannot only think about the need for the 8 million New Yorkers who live here. We also have to plan for those 57 million who came this year, last year, and that number continue growing because people throughout the world, they want to come and see the great thing that we have in the city. So what I believe is that as we plan for the future, especially I represent Inwood. I don't know how many of you have been there. However, I can tell you that Inwood has the second greener area after Central Park. Now it's a hidden treasure that we have there. And yes, we are not in the Midtown. We are not so connected with the South, but we have the George Washington Bridge and the Cross Bronx. We have the Metro North that also stopped in Riverdale, that stopped in Fodder. So we are very important if we plan the development of our city for the future. This at this moment, I had the support of the mayor and the EDC, and we are starting a discussion to rezone more than 100 acres in Inwood. And that 100 acres will bring thousands of new jobs that I hope to see focus on health and technology. But also we will build thousands of new apartments in that particular area. And for me, some people say, well, why you focus also, why you also include water transportation when we have to be taking care of the train system and the car? I say, I see everything with the same priority. I believe that, you know, recently I sent a letter to the MTA and I got a signature of more than 20 elected officials and asked the MTA to include in the next capital plan to have a shuttle train that connect from the A train at Broadway and 207 all the way going through Fodder to the Metro North at Western and Fodder. So I believe, you know, that we have to continue investing and improving our train services, our buses, but we cannot leave water transportation behind. And when we look at the west side, I see the potential there. You know, not only to increase the water transportation for those who live here, but when I had taken the boat with my daughter, when she'd been doing an assignment from her school on water transportation, and going from the South Seaport and going to Brooklyn and coming through this area, a lot of people who got into the boat, they are tourists who also are using the water transportation to go and discover and see what we have to offer. So I believe that it is possible to establish the West Side Ferry that connect from the Wall Street area, from the Battery Park, going along through the 39th Street, at the 72nd Street, stop at 125th, and then end it in Inwood area. If we are able to include that ferry services among the need that the mayor has established, and I have to thank the mayor because he put the money where his mouth is. When he made a commitment to invest $54 million capital to improve the ferry transportation, that's what the leader is. It's not only to talk, but also to put the money in those areas. I hope that in this way of how we've been working together with this mayor, we can be able to see our West Side Ferry line that we serve not only the 350,000 New Yorkers who use the one, who use the C and the A train moving from this area all the way to Inwood, but also to serve the tourist population. Thank you.
Okay. I'm really glad that Roberta Weisbrod was able to join us. She is one of the leading thinkers on both maritime freight and passenger movement, on maritime industry generally. And has probably forgotten more than most of us will ever know about how to make the waterfront work to support city and regional economies. So I think you have some interesting examples internationally, as well as probably some things to tell us about our own waterfront. Thank you.
Thank you, Joan. And I, too, am very thrilled to be on this panel and following you, Councilman. That was very interesting. I have an international perspective. I'm also the executive director of a not-for-profit worldwide ferry safety association, and I've been looking at and working with ferries internationally for over a decade, partly as a member of the International Ferry Association and then as head of the not-for-profit to make ferries safer all over the world. But as such, have seen trends in how ferries are devised. And there's two things I want to talk about, two interrelated, like our blue urbanism speaker. The one is that ferries have changed in their role, especially in New York. There's an evolution going on. Initially, ferries were just used to cross the river, like the Staten Island Ferry and the New York Waterway. And then as well, ferries are used to connect the inner city with the far-flung suburbs, like the Sea Streak Ferry. But more recently, over the last decade or so, closer, okay. Hope everyone heard the build-up. More recently, ferries are becoming a linear urban ferry. So we see them in London, Stockholm, Brisbane, Sydney. Okay, can't hear. Okay, so I'll stand. Thank you, I'll be delighted to. Okay, better? Okay, so ferries, which initially were just used to cross the river, like New York Waterway, and initially to connect inner cities with the suburbs like Sea Streak, are now linear urban ferries in London, as well as Bangkok, Stockholm, Sydney. And they're not to replace bridges, but rather to complement and parallel existing transportation, because that transportation is congested and will now ease the movement of people. So they're deliberately providing for ease of congestion. We see that happening in some of the most congested developing cities. Manila just put in a linear urban ferry on the Pasig River, and Mumbai is actively considering it, as is and Dhaka and Lagos. So it's a new thing, but how do you support that linear urban ferry that we have experienced in New York City on the East River Ferry? Multiple stops, relieve congestion, relieve places where you don't have good connections, like in Williamsburg. How do we really support that kind of ferry as we go to build the new ones? And the answer is, and Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance has been continuously raising it, but we might have new tools in our arsenal. The answer is integration with other forms of mass transit, including the ferries themselves. So there's someone in Australia, Rob Sandel, who has the programs that you can hop from one ferry system to another, from a New York Waterway to a New York water taxi to a Sea Streak. But there's also the whole integration. We want to have frequent service. It might involve many smaller ferries, as Rick Scarano's pointed out. But there are also electronic tools that could help us. And I think we in New York City are almost a kiss away from making that happen. And that's the general transit feed specifications. When you go onto Google Maps, you can find out how to get to the place where you're going by transit very quickly. The only ferry system that's currently connected with that in New York City is the Staten Island Ferry. I did a preliminary research a few months ago, And every ferry system in New York City does have some kind of GTFS, but it's not integrated with the Metropolitan Transit Authority's system yet. It could be. I mean, we all want the buses to be there to connect with the ferries, but I'm thinking that if the ferries can now possibly connect with the bus system and just change the schedule so that the East River Ferry on East 34th Street, which is a very weak part of the system, could be connected much more readily. So we can strengthen this system by looking across the world. GTFS is used in many cities in Asia already for many, many systems. We can do better with it. And I applaud Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance for driving the creation of the ferry system. Few more thoughts. The GTFS will not only help for relieving congestion, but it will help for tourism and after another Sandy event. And finally, last word, baseball season, to relieve the road, the congestion on the roads. If people knew about how to get to the games by ferry, they would get there more often and we'd have less trouble when we try to go north. So thanks a lot.
Okay. Here.
I got to say, GTFS is close to a lot of our hearts. I was doing my homework for this panel. I was trying to be a good moderator and try to take the ferry just as a regular trip to work this week. What's special about GTFS is it isn't a posted schedule. It's a live feed of when the vehicle is actually going to arrive. So every day I would get to the ferry landing 5 minutes before the scheduled arrival, just in time to see the ferry pulling out. So wait 20 minutes for the next ferry. Oh, I'll get a cup of coffee. There isn't anywhere to get a cup of coffee. So I think we've got some things we can improve on technology, on landside connections, and so forth. I want to now go to probably the person who can say the most about how we make ferries not just a toy for tourists, not just an amenity for waterfront developers of pricey real estate, but a real part of the everyday transit system, a part of the network that all of us rely on, and that would be Gene Rushinoff, Executive Director of the Strap Hangers Alliance and Staff Attorney of NYPIRG. Is that the right?
Close enough.
Okay. Close to the mic, Gene. It's karaoke time.
Can everybody hear me? I have a little sore throat. Okay. You hear me back there? Well, maybe not. Well, how's that? Maybe better. Okay. So I feel like I should note the view from this table. It's amazing to see
scores and scores of people. Yeah.
Hello. Well, it's just great to see so many people here that are interested in the future of the waterfront. I think maybe that deserves a round of applause. And it also looks oddly like a floating Leonard's of Great Neck from here. When Mayor de Blasio announced his ferry proposal, I and some other groups in the transportation community, reacted a little sourly. I'm not here to rain on the parade. I think it's great that there's activism around better transportation in the city, and there are different communities and different needs. So it's great to see. I said that I was a ferry skeptic, and I knew I was in big trouble when I started getting emails from Istanbul. I have a couple of pieces of advice from a few decades of advocating for a mode of transportation, mainly subways and buses. And I hope it doesn't come across like very general nostrums, but I think some of these things that are cliches turn out to be true. So one that's really critical for activists fighting for better use of the waterfront for transportation is not to get discouraged. You know, there are a lot of bumps in the road, and things are slower than you'd want. When I started on advocating for better mass transit, the ridership in the city, this is the early 80s, had dipped to its lowest level since 1917. And trains broke down at a rate 20 times that they do now. And the New York Post ran a contest on tips for surviving the subways, and one of them was never get on a car that has a chalk outline of a body on the floor. So it was a tough time, and you know, social change comes slowly. I work with a lot of students, and I advise them that if they think they're going to see something happen in a year, it's probably not going to be that way. Mayor de Blasio's plans are very ambitious, 13 select bus service routes, like Joan. It's something that I feel very passionately about. Is a great achievement, but when I tell my daughters that they're going to build like 12 more, 13 more of these things, she says, how come it takes so long? You know, that's just a reality of this area. So another thing is that, you know, these days people have to be very precise about their goals. You know, performance measures and metrics are really critical to evaluating projects. And I noted in the EDC Ferry study from 2013 that they said they were talking about some of the waterfront routes in Brooklyn and Queens, and they said these are forecast to generate significant ridership and can potentially operate with modest public subsidies. So when I see the word modest, I think, well, what does that mean? You know, having agreed upon definitions and goals are really critical. Another one is the goals is to provide fast and reliable service. I can tell you that in the transit area, we've been fighting for 30 years for definitions that really reflect what the riders, you know, would qualify as reliable or fast service. And you know, getting definitions that everyone agrees on is really important. You know, one of your challenges is that the ideal in transportation is a one-seat ride. As you grow older, this becomes more and more important. You know, switching modes of transportation is tough. People would rather, you know, walk a couple of blocks than, you know, transfer from the L to the, you name it, the A. Probably two of the most scary words in mass transit are shuttle bus. You really never know where you're going to end up. So, may I leave you with this? We find to advocate some of these goals, humor is a good thing to have on your side. And I don't know what the advocacy choices are for the waterfront community, but you know, we annually trick or treat the MTA board of directors, and the politicians and the reporters covering them can't resist free food. They held a hearing on increasing the fare and the fortune cookie. We doctored the fortune cookie so they had new fortunes inside of it, and one of them said, raising the fare will wreak havoc with your love life. So, you know, I don't know if there's a chance to show up at a EDC board meeting or other governmental events, but, you know, I think that, you know, in a city as big as New York, getting a message out is really difficult. So, you know, those are some general views. I think you have a great cause, and you have many ways to advocate it, and you know, you can get it if you really want. Thanks.
Thank you, Gene. A lot of words of wisdom there. Sam Schwartz, in case anybody in the room is not aware of it, is the author of probably the most visionary plan for funding New York City's and the region's transit needs that we've seen in a long time. And in the context of that plan, ferries become not, you know, not kind of a little nicety on the side, but a thing that we can readily afford, that we can expand even maybe more aggressively than what the mayor has proposed, and cover some of those areas of Upper Manhattan, other places that are not yet on this map. So I'd like to have Sam talk about how he sees the ferry plan fitting into the big transit picture, and especially the economics of it.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me? Okay, thank you very much for that introduction, Joan. Roberta, I would very much love to take the subway to see the first place, take the ferry to see the first place Mets, but they discontinued it, so we've got to get a ferry going to the Mets. They're our first place team at the moment, best record in New York City. The Move New York plan is a plan that's meant to address a lot of our transit needs and transportation needs, not just our transit needs. It involves changing the tolling structure that we have in New York City, which is simply the result of three men making decisions. Mayor William Gaynor in 1911, who removed the tolls from the four East River bridges right after an assassination attempt on his life. And the police say no connection. I've asked for a cold case file to be opened on that. And that has continued for the remaining century. And as a result, bridges in the 1980s, I had to shut the entire Williamsburg Bridge, replace it with a ferry system. I had to ban trains from the Manhattan Bridge. I had cables snap on the Brooklyn Bridge, killing a Japanese tourist. I had to shut down the upper roadway of the Queensboro Bridge and the outer roadways because we kept the bridges free. And I put free in quotation marks. They are not free. We are paying, and we are paying so much more for those bridges than we would have paid had we each paid a toll every time we crossed those bridges. So in our plan, we look at those bridges that are now subsidizing transportation into the Central Business District, like the Throgsneck Bridge, which has no subways across it, which has no origins destinations that include the Central Business District, the Rockaway Bridges, the Verrazano Bridge, the four Bronx bridges, and we slash those tolls by 40 to 50%. We return the tolls on the four East River bridges, and we do it at 60th Street Screen Line. In addition, we have, for those people in Manhattan that cause congestion, we have a surcharge on taxi cab rides south of 96th Street, and today the Metropolitan Taxi Board of Trade is coming out in support of that because they see the increase in speeds. As an ex-cab driver, I could tell you our credo is you pick up the fare and you try to get rid of them as fast as possible. That is what we try to do as cab drivers. We want to move fast through the city without hitting anybody on that. So we end up raising, through that and a few other fees, about $1.5 billion a year we net. And we always saw this as a need for a complete and balanced transportation system. So ferries from the very start were part of that. And we included some capital money, and we're looking at some operating money on it. But the bulk of the money will go towards transit, to rail transit, to projects that the MTA has already programmed, and perhaps to some other projects that's extending the Second Avenue line into Harlem. There is money for that in this plan, for in the Metro North stations that would go into Penn Station. There is money for that. And we have money to do a number of other transportation initiatives. In addition to garner the support, and because it's the right thing to do, a quarter of the revenue that's raised will also go to roads and bridges, which are in terrible shape, and they are getting worse. 25 years ago, I mentioned how I closed so many facilities because there was no dedicated funding source. We had a pretty good maintenance record for the next 15 or 20 years while we remembered the events of the 1980s and the 1970s. And I can tell you there is no constituency, there is no group that I can assemble like this that will stand up and say, paint our infrastructure, clean it, maintain it, basically. Maybe I can get a rowboat. My friend Brian would be there with me, and that's about the constituency that we would get. Yet all of you are going to pay for those so-called free bridges if we keep them free. But that is a revenue source for a balanced transportation system. The other thing that I think is important, is always important, is look at history. Of course, we had ferries 100 years ago. We had lots of ferries back and forth, and I used to take my bike on the Staten Island Ferry, and Gene was there with me probably on a few of those rides. We're both Brooklyn boys. But who has been successful of in recent history? And that's the author imperator, ferries. And the reason that was successful is he solved that transportation problem on the other end when you got to Manhattan. And he does have buses that are really well coordinated to take people to 34th Street, 42nd Street, Broadway and Houston, wherever they're going. Now, this is an era in which ferries are even going to do even better, and they should have those kinds of transportation systems. But now with City Bike, you have a built-in transportation system. If we're smart enough to place it at every ferry terminal, we have millennials that are willing to walk and take their own bikes, and we need policies that will encourage both walking and biking while we rebuild our transit system. So, thank you. So with a crowd like this, I'd like to invite you to paint our infrastructure conference we're holding next week, and maybe we'll finally get something done to take care of our bridges. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Sam. And you're chartering a rowboat to have that conference in? Is that
yes,
what you said? Terrific. I want to remind everybody we've got some time for questions because these panelists kept it short and snappy. So grab an index card, write your question on that card, and it'll come up here. I'm not going to take raised hands yet because I'm the moderator and I got my own questions. Where are those cards? Jeez. Okay. I'm going to vamp a little bit with a question. Breaking news this week, the subways are crowded and sometimes they run late. Okay, shocker. And interestingly, some of the subway stations that have seen the biggest percent increases in ridership are exactly those on the Brooklyn-Queens side that are the first station the train hits when it comes out of the East River tunnels, all right? So we've got Vernon Boulevard on the number 7 train. We've got Bedford Avenue on the L. We've got, you know, a surprise, you know, a dark horse coming up from the back of the pack, Marcy Avenue on the J and Z train. So what's going on here? These are stations, we suspect that a lot of the new ridership in those stations is coming from new residential development that has taken place along and near the waterfronts that those stations serve. So people are actually walking inland when what they need to do is get across the river. So I'd like to throw it out to my panelists. What would it take for the ferries to do a better job of taking some of that burden off of the transit system? Is it, you know, is it the ferry landings themselves? Is it the legibility of either, you know, the ground connections, the lack of bus connections? Is it lack of legibility of the ferry system itself and people's difficulty in knowing, like, if I take that hike down to the waterfront, will there be a boat there? So, from anybody. Roberta.
Thank you. I would say the GTFS would really, really, I share your pain. I've been there. I've gone down to Waterfront and the boat wasn't there. And you really, if we had that GTFS, it would happen. And I wanted to just say one other thing. I have a lot of confidence in EDC as it's currently constituted, both with Andrew Genn leading the fray and now James Wong, who is director of ferries, who's actually a GTFS wonk and knows it very, very well. I think there's an opportunity in the new planning to insist that all the ferries get engaged in GTFS and make the information public so that we could really do proper planning for our own trips.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Gene.
Just the transit authority is kind of fallen in love with the millennials who are using more and more their facilities. So they show a photo of one station in Greenpoint, and they have you try and guess the time, and it looks like it's Times Square during the New Year, and it turns out to be like Marcy Avenue at midnight on a weekday. So if you want to go clubbing and you don't want to have a car that you could destroy or forget where you parked, you just take the train, which leads me to think that this is going to be a tough one, convincing people to go down to a ferry. And you know the system. It's the map is up on the wall. You know, even if it's a terrible trip, you know where you're going to go. So I think it's a big challenge.
I agree with Roberta that information is the number one thing that sways people. When I worked on the Barclays Center, we tested everything, giving people free Metro cards, giving them free hot dogs, T-shirts, whatever. The biggest swing we got when we did focus groups that met with those hardcore drivers was giving them information on how to use the transit system. We got a 9% swing, and then that was supported by the actual event when we redid the surveys. So giving information to people, there are probably a lot of those new people that are living in those areas, don't have a clue when, where, but the millennials are so easy to teach. You can just have an app and it'll point you in the right direction and you'll be able to use it. So we do have advantages in 2015 that we did not have in the past. But again, make it very comfortable for biking, comfortable for walking. Make sure that those routes now are not only clearly marked, but they are safe.
Yeah, just to add to that, the lower fare of $2.75 will go a long way, but even bigger than that, but something that we won't see in the short term is pushing the MTA. Oh, hello. Pushing the MTA to adopt new fare card technology that will allow for integration of New York City Transit with the ferry system. And adding to Sam's comments about biking, with the expansion of City Bike through 2017, 16 of these 21 landings will be served by City Bike, so that'll go a long ways.
I think it's also the approach that the city has when it comes to water transportation. I think that water transportation was seen in the past that, you know, 20 years ago, especially when you were starting, working so hard on this initiative as something that was luxury, as something that was now accessible for working class and middle class. And I think that now with the mayor also approach where he say the cost of someone to get into the ferry should be the same as someone that paid for the Metro card. So we as a city, as a government, we had to come on board. And as we also cover 40% of the cost of someone who get into the subway or into the buses, we also have to see how we find a way on being supported so that the cost of transportation for someone that decides to get into the ferry should be affordable too.
I could just say a few words about the one fare ride that you can take your same Metro card and go onto the ferry. When I've spoken to ferry operators, they've expressed the concern that the MTA would hang on to the, I don't know how they know it, but would hang on to the fare, and it would be a month or so in which they wouldn't have access to their money. So it's a question of liquidity. I think it could be readily solved, but it just has to be addressed in order to make that happen.
Yeah, that does sound like a problem that could easily be solved. Maybe it could be built into the terms of the ferry concession agreement or whatever it is, but that's if it's 1 month worth of cash flow, that's less than a rounding error. There are a couple of questions relating to gentrification of the waterfront, so I kind of want to go there. A lot of the development we saw under the Bloomberg administration on the waterfront didn't really prioritize affordability. It's luxury development. It was rebranding of, you know, once gritty industrial neighborhoods, et cetera. What are the things we need to do, A, to make, you know, we've touched on making ferries affordable, making it not a two-fare zone, not a double swipe for folks in the many public housing communities along the waterfront and for other working class folks. What do you see as the proper relationship between developers of waterfront property and a ferry system that really adds value to their property, and EDC has calculated that value?
I would just say that we need to look at value capture associated with that increased property value adjacent to the ferry landings, and there's techniques for capturing that value and applying it to improve the ferry network and other transit.
Well, my thing is, when it comes to gentrification or how like expanding the ferry or the water access to the water, it has an impact. For me, I always say that I'm not afraid of changing. What I believe that also we all always have to work to be sure that in that formula, people that have been living in a particular area, they stay there at the same time that we welcome new people coming to those part of the district. So what I believe is that what we have to have in mind is how can we keep, you know, let's say in this case, transportation accessible, those using the ferry. But when it comes to the increase of the property value in the community, I think it's up to how do we, you know, there's things that we don't control. You know, and we live in a free market society. However, there is certain elements that we can put in play from the government perspective to be sure that we keep some control of the increase of those value.
Yeah, thank you very much. I want to add to that, the city does things that create land value all the time. We build infrastructure like ferry docks. The biggest way we create land value is we rezone, right? Stroke of the pen, and a site that had a negative value in the market because of its environmental and infrastructure liabilities all of a sudden becomes a multi-million or multi-billion dollar asset. So I think the question for us, both as equity advocates and as transportation advocates, is how can we be more transparent and more thoughtful when we do things as a public that create value? How do we allocate that value among the many different needs? Affordable housing being important, affordable housing in which people have long-term secure tenure, and then how do we also make sure that we're meeting the many other needs, including transportation, that come out of those increases in density? If anybody wants to riff on that, please feel free.
Just the big victory on this. A developer wants to build a 64-story super modern tower at the corner of 42nd and Vanderbilt Avenue, and the community and the local officials really held out to get something real. In the past, the transit authority has gotten like some escalators. You know those escalators because they're the ones that just don't work, and you just assume you're going to have to walk up them, like the Zeckendorfs at the Union Square, or the ones at 34th Street that have been in litigation for, you know, decades. And this is the city negotiated the largest zoning bonus, transit bonus in history. So, $220 million are going to be spent to make Grand Central 42nd Street have more space, more entrance and exits, more room at the edge of the platform, so it isn't that close. You know, I think it's a good precedent, and there are going to be more skyscrapers in our future, like it or not. And, you know, with a city that plays a meaner game in negotiations, it can make a big difference.
Yeah. I think one of the things that we shouldn't forget, and we should do value capture and look at affordable housing, but the waterfront was not the place to hang out in the 30s and the 40s. And if you look at where the NYCHA housing is built, it's all along the waterfront or within a mile of the waterfront. Tremendous amount of NYCHA housing. It would be a big mistake if we did not go into that housing, figure out what would get people to use the system, just like the private sector did it, just like it was done at Barclays or any developer. Find out what is going to get them to ride the system. We already have tens of thousands of residents that we shouldn't forget.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think as the details of the mayor's plan become clear, all of us who care about this would be in a good position to be advocating for phasing in of not only a physical MetroCard swipe, but a free transfer. We already have, you know, the MTA and the Port Authority have figured out how to share revenue from swipes at the JFK AirTrain. So there, even with the crappy card technology we have, that's already possible. I don't think we have to wait for contactless fares or, you know, mobile phone payments to get that, and I think it's worth fighting for. Lots of questions coming in about that other river, the one back there, the Hudson River, and what kind of ferry connectivity do we want to see both between Upper Manhattan and other parts of the city, but also potentially for reverse commuting, for folks who might want to commute to jobs that are up the Hudson Valley. So Councilmember Rodriguez and anybody else that wants to speak to that.
Well, my vision for the ferry that I want to build, Dykeman La Marina, is something that my vision is to use a ferry not only to expand water transportation from this area to Inwood, but also my vision is to connect also farmers from the Hudson Valley, that they can be able to bring their product and opening a market in the Inwood Park. So, but I also put them, this is not only a vision that I have. I already put $500,000 in this fiscal budget, where I'm committed to also to continue investing more money as we are getting close to negotiating this budget this year. So I will build a ferry in Dykeman. And my vision for that ferry is not only for the water transportation, but also, as you say, to provide opportunities so farmers from the Hudson Valley, also they can bring their product, and we should be able to buy fresh product there at the Inwood Park.
Thank you. Several questions about environmental impacts of ferries themselves, specifically air quality, that some ferries seem to burn cleaner than others. So I guess I'll call on the official wonk of this panel to talk about ferry engine technology and how clean can they be.
Well, not an expert on ferry engine technology, but I do know that some operators are experimenting with biodiesel. The city's RFP has a number of provisions regarding ensuring that the vessels are as environmentally friendly as possible. Doesn't mean there aren't limitations to that. Roberta, did you have more to add to that? You.
I mean, the Society of Naval Architects and Marine Engineers is having an issue of marine technology coming out in July called Ferries at the Cutting Edge. I'm the guest editor, so I happen to know what's going to be in it. And it's there are electric ferries, there are cable ferries, there are solar-powered ferries, there are wind turbine ferries. So there's a lot happening. And you know that makes economic sense if you take all the issues that have to be put into it. So yeah, there are a lot of possibilities out there, and they're cleaner and greener and cost effective. So yes,
it's a little different. I take these challenges really seriously. We're alongside a river that was supposed to be filled in a couple of blocks from downtown to midtown for a highway known as Westway. And it didn't happen, even though people said it was something that was going to be good for the city. So these challenges raise issues about the environment that I think are important to take seriously.
Okay. Couple questions about dock and landing location planning. One of the things that New York City DOT has been fabulous with has been the involvement of local communities in the detailed planning of select bus service. So it isn't just that they drew 13 lines on a map and said, this is where the routes are going to be. We'll be back in 2 years with your bus. But rather that they have incrementally, in each of the affected communities, gone out and brought people along from kind of the very broad brush, big picture of what streets will the select bus service routes run on, to things like how will the lanes be configured? Will they be along the curb? Will they be along the medians? to where the station's going to be and how are the interconnections with the train lines going to be. And one would hope that EDC would have a similar process in working through the implementation of the, you know, the details of ferry system design. Because people have, you know, if you're a user, you have a perspective on how should the landside connections be made, what is important, you know, like what would be the most valuable bus connections to bring close to the ferry and which ones maybe are not worth the trouble. What, there were a lot of opinions expressed from the room about it being unnecessarily difficult or expensive to bring your bike along on the ferry. That if, you know, ferries and bikes are like mac and cheese, they just are born to go together. But some ferry operators charge extra to bring a bike. Some, it is not always obvious that there is secure all-day bike parking if you wanted to leave your own bike at a ferry stop because maybe you don't want to use it. So, you know, when you get to your destination side. So, panel, what kind of process would you like to see in the months going forward as the city actually moves forward to implement the plan? How do you imagine folks in ferry communities and in communities that are not yet on this map being engaged for their input? Gene.
Well, you know, you mentioned the select bus service process. They do at least two things. One is they hold periodic open houses to give you an idea of what their current thinking is and to engage you in discussions about what you think about it. Then they also set up citizens advisory committees, or CACs. Everything has an anagram. And the people from the business community and residents and nonprofit agencies, you know, form a board that gives pretty good information to the DOT officials about how the community is going to react to certain initiatives. So those are two things I would strongly advise EDC to do, and to do it over the course of the life of the project, not just like one event and then moving on.
I also would like to add, I have a bill at the City Council, which I will be introducing very soon, that also is calling for the MTA and the DOT to address the desert community that we have, an area where we need to improve transportation. And what we are calling is for the city to put out a plan every 5 years of area in our city where we have opportunity to improve transportation. It means connecting the buses with the train or connecting with the ferry or other area where people are isolated, where people are relying on the $1 van, where we also had to improve more the selectable services. So what we are looking to establish in the city is a plan where we say every 5 years we revise it and we take the input of residents from those communities and we take their suggestion on how we can improve transportation in those areas.
Wow.
Thanks. As indicated in the city's RFP, about 50% or so of these ferry landings are under environmental review by EDC. And the Waterfront Alliance would certainly encourage and like to work with the city to engage locals in that process, that outreach process. There's a great network of ferry activists that are already out there. We'd love to help the city tap into that network and be a part of assisting and facilitating with the outreach.
Okay, I think we're just about almost out of time. So I think I would like to take the Waterfront Alliance up on that offer because I think they're, you know, it's EDC is, you know, one of the cool kids among the city agencies. They have that rep. They do things in a way that borrows heavily from the city's corporate culture, often for good, for speed, for efficiency, for high touch, but sometimes for ill, in that things are not as transparent, processes are not as open to public engagement as we might like. So I think there's nobody better positioned than the Waterfront Alliance to kind of spearhead real substantive engagement so that we make this ferry system really ship to shore, that we really make it perform as well as it possibly can, that we maximize the placemaking benefits, the economic and job creation benefits, and above all, the connectivity benefits, so that it really delivers on that promise. I'm going to close now. Thank you all very much, and we'll see you in 15 minutes.